Hi, how are you? I hope you're having a great day. So I bought a new video editor the beginning of January, and I'm slowly learning how to use it. I told you about my technical inabilities, but really I'm finding it to be quite fun. And I just learned how to edit sound with music, my voice with music. So thank you for your patience as I get this all figured out. Well, temperatures are dropping again.
Today in Fort Wayne, it should feel as high as 13 and as low as 1 due to wind chill.
Eeks. Like all cells, muscle cells depend on metabolism to function correctly. Muscle cells convert sugar and fat into adenosine triphosphate, or ATP, through the work of enzymes. I mentioned ATP in my last video. ATP enables muscles to contract and function normally. But when there's too much sugar in the blood, insulin stores the excess sugar in our fat cells, causing them to get larger. So today, I want to talk about sugar, insulin, and insulin resistance, and whether you're at risk for type 2 diabetes. Here we go. The average American consumes around 17 teaspoons of added sugar per day. The American Heart Association recommends no more than 25 grams or 6 teaspoons of sugar per day. Avoiding sugar is difficult. I know. Many food manufacturers add large amounts of sugar in our food to make it taste better. A high intake of carbs and sugar tends to serve as comfort food, and we might use it as a coping strategy. But that amount of sugar correlates to extra non-nutritive calories. About 18% of patients with type 2 diabetes have fibromyalgia, and I can attest to a love of sugar. For sure. And I got in a vicious cycle of eating too many sweets, but I had conditioned myself to believe that I would probably have a high BMI for the rest of my life. And I thought, well, this is how I'm going to look and feel, so I might as well embrace it. But is that right? Can you relate? If sugar is an inflammatory food, as they say, and those extra sugars are getting stored in our fat, then what am I doing to myself? It can be a mindset and a rut. But then one day I said, enough. That little bit of sugar that my husband may put in a recipe is fine, but a dozen chocolate chip cookies, well, not so fine. According to a study, insulin resistance causes dysfunction in the brain microvasculature, leading to focal cerebral hypoperfusion, which is decreased blood flow going through an organ, and similar brain perfusion abnormalities, which is a process of oxygenated blood delivered to the tissues, are present in patients with fibromyalgia. Perhaps this also relates to our mitochondria. So eating too much sugar can lead to weight gain and insulin resistance. which is related to metabolic conditions. There are foods that are considered to be inflammatory because they increase inflammation, aggravate food sensitivities, or sometimes both. Sugar is at the top of the list. In 2013, researchers investigated the nutritional intake of fibro patients and their barriers to health. First, they recognized that the role of BMI as a factor influencing fibromyalgia symptom severity and quality of life. Weight loss improves BMI, our symptoms, and our quality of life. I mean, that seems reasonable. The biggest barrier to accomplishing weight loss, however, was the participants' confidence in their ability to perform healthy behaviors, and that's called self-efficacy. They unexpectedly found that participants had a higher carbohydrate and sucrose / sugar intake, which correlated to their lower quality of life. And a footnote here. Other studies negate that people with fibromyalgia eat any differently than people without fibromyalgia. I know that I don't like to be categorized for sure, but sugar was my nemesis. But it may not be yours. What do you think? When we limit our sugar intake, it helps to control weight. When we're overweight, our body is stressed out. We get fatigued and fat is stored, which can lead to inflammation. We know that soft drinks and candy, cookies and cakes are full of sugar, but apples and berries are good for us in small amounts. These are foods rated by the glycemic index. Read the labels on food packages. Nutritional labels can state sugar as glucose, fructose, or sucrose. But there's also refined carbs like breads, pastries, and white rice that can cause our blood sugar to spike. These foods are digested quickly and cause our blood sugar to drop quickly, so we're hungry quicker. Most dietary specialists say that eating whole grain sources are better than refined grains because they're digested more slowly because the fiber in whole grain is sticky in our colon and holds the sugar in our system to be used as energy in our cells. But in refined grains, there's no fiber, minerals, or vitamins, so the sugar gets stored. I guess it's brown rice and oats for me. Interesting stuff. I put a short video in the description section about the differences between whole and refined grains. It only makes sense that if your blood sugar levels are in the pre-diabetic range, that you need to get your blood sugar under control. If you don't, you can progress to type 2 diabetes. High fiber, low fat, healthy foods, and lower sugar intake should accomplish that. And did you know that 8 out of 10 people in America have pre-diabetes and don't even know it? It's a serious condition. You're at risk, as I've said, for type 2 diabetes, heart disease, and stroke. Losing just 10 to 14 pounds for a 200-pound person, and your risk goes down, according to the CDC. Regular exercise is needed, and this is what it looks like for me. I get so stiff when I'm sitting in this chair that I have to get up and stretch often, sometimes while filming a video. Insulin resistance happens when cells in our muscles, fat, and liver don't respond as they should to insulin, a hormone in our pancreas essential for life and for regulating blood glucose levels. Insulin resistance can be temporary or chronic and is treatable in most cases. So if insulin resistance becomes chronic, it leads to prediabetes and type 2 diabetes. Prediabetes is when your blood sugar levels are higher than normal, but not high enough to be diagnosed as diabetes. Have you struggled with this? As I said, I have. And I found it to be a little bit scary. I have to, as much as possible, give up sugar to get my blood sugar and my A1C under control because I don't want it to progress to type 2 diabetes. Insulin resistance can affect anyone when the cells in your muscles, fat, and liver don't respond well to insulin and can't use glucose in our blood for energy. We're insulin resistant. Temporary insulin resistance can occur from taking steroid medication for a brief period, for example. But excess body fat, especially around the belly, and a lack of physical activity are two main factors of insulin resistance. About one of every three adults may have insulin resistance. Hyperinsulinemia is when your body starts to produce an increased amount of insulin, and this is the beginning of the development of insulin resistance. Hyperinsulinemia is associated with higher triglyceride levels, hardening of the arteries, and high blood pressure. So insulin resistance is the main feature of metabolic syndrome, which is linked to that spare tire around the waist. And let me tell you, it's been the hardest to lose this time around. I'm sure age has something to do with it, but I've been off sugar for 10 months now, and I've got a little bit more to go around the waist. It's just hanging in there. But I got my blood sugar normalized and my A1C under control. If you have insulin resistance and your pancreas is able to increase insulin production, you won't have any symptoms. That's true. I had no idea the first time I was diagnosed with prediabetes. But over time, the cells in our pancreas will slow down and wear out because it can't keep up any longer. That's when blood sugar rises, called hyperglycemia. And you'll notice symptoms like increased thirst, peeing a lot, hunger all the time, blurry vision, headaches, skin infections, and cuts and sores that just won't heal. People with hypothyroidism or Cushing's syndrome, hormonal disorders, can cause insulin resistance. But you can also carry a gene or two that can make you susceptible to insulin resistance. I carry a gene for type 2 diabetes, but I also have two copies of the farmer gene variant that are protective in processing sugar, and a third and fourth gene that gives me a slightly decreased risk of type 2. But I also know that diet matters. If you have not had a glucose tolerance test, you might think about having that done. Also, the hemoglobin A1C test will show your glucose levels over the past 3 months, and a lipid panel to check your cholesterol levels and triglycerides should be ordered. Lifestyle modifications are the best treatment. Eat a healthy diet. Do your best to be active to increase glucose energy usage and improve muscle insulin sensitivity. And if you need to, lose weight. And according to research, just losing 7% of your excess weight can reduce the onset of type 2 diabetes by 58%. These modifications will help over time. You will reduce your insulin resistance, lower your blood glucose levels, decrease blood pressure, decrease triglyceride and LDL, bad cholesterol, and raise your HDL, good cholesterol. I've struggled with all of that, except for a high blood pressure. Although I think my blood pressure has been a little higher than normal, but still within that okay range. But that's because I have vasovagal syncope, which is a low blood pressure. I have a doctor appointment coming up in a couple of weeks, and I'm sure she'll order all of these tests again to see where I'm at. But my last one, almost 6 months ago, everything was normal. There are causes of insulin resistance that are not reversible. So talk to your doctor. And there isn't just one diet that works for all of us. Instead, you have to figure out what works for you. Perhaps take some of what I've said today and try it. Today was basically my story, but I hope you will share below if you have a similar story or something completely different. I'd love to hear from you. There appears to be a connection between ingesting sugar and starch, insulin levels, body-wide inflammation, and pain and fibromyalgia. But there isn't a consensus on this, so it may depend on each person. So, I hope you found this interesting. I'm a work in progress, and I wish I would have taken my health more seriously when I was younger. What's really cool today is I can just Google search anything, and that's made research so much more fun. I send you gentle hugs and support. Love you. My voice was sound. But I got my blood